Hey there, this is Josh Fechter from Limbal CMS, and today I'm going to give you a basic to intermediate introduction to the fault tree analysis process. FTA is one of the many root cause analysis techniques, so if you haven't watched a root cause analysis video yet on our channel, then I highly recommend you do so before continuing with this one. But if you have a good idea, then let's go ahead and dive into fault tree analysis. And in this video, we'll see its use cases, FTA types, symbols, processes, and helpful software solutions. So let's go ahead and jump right in. So what is fault tree analysis? FTA is used as a part of the root cause analysis process. It's a graphical as well as a mathematical tool used to analyze potential for failure for a machine or a system. The graphical elements used to model FTA are called fault trees. They are acyclical graphs that resemble the structure of a tree. That's where the name comes from. FTA works by trying to model how failure propagates through a system. So to conduct FTA, a catastrophic event for a process is imagined, and the team conducting the analysis will think about conditions that can lead to such an event, and all reasons for why the event could happen will be mapped relationally using Boolean logic. From there, the team goes down the list of causes till the root causes are completely mapped out. When finished, the fault tree diagram helps the team to identify the primary issues that led to a catastrophic failure, so they can apply proper corrective and preventive measures in the future. And so which industries leverage FTA? This model was developed by Bell Telephone Laboratories many years ago, and it was an attempt to increase safety in the US Air Force system. Later on though, the FTA methodology was adopted and popularized by Boeing, so it began to move more towards private enterprise. And today, fault tree analysis has been used by organizations to analyze the failure potential across systems and processes in many industries, including not just aerospace, but also power generation, defense and cybersecurity, nuclear operations, specialty chemical manufacturing, pharmaceuticals and healthcare, disaster management, and much more. So let's go ahead and take a look at exactly what organizations in these industries do with FT analysis. In general, fault trees are very useful for preventing future failures for new workflows, products, and services. In these cases, the fault tree analysis is done at the time of the design. Having this information up front helps to identify critical areas of concern and take preventive actions. The analysis can also be done during operation to bolster the subsystems and components that have a high probability to cause a major incident. In both cases, doing this rigorous analysis ensures that complex systems operate safely and reliably. And in this image, you can see the fault trees that together build the FT analysis. They have a standard set of symbols and nomenclature so that the analysis can be understood across different plants and industries. Depending on the resource you're looking at, the visual representation of certain symbols can vary slightly from what you see in this image, but the differences are small though, so no one should have an issue recognizing the symbols. And the fault tree graph represents the flow and relationship between a series of activities. The activities are visually representative as nodes. And as you can see in this image, the fault tree diagrams have two main types of nodes. You have events and gates. Let's take a closer look at each one of them. These represent event types that come up in fault trees. Events are occurrences in a system, like the failure of a subsystem or a failure of an individual component. Event symbols will have only one input and one output. As the name implies, the top event, TE, is the event at the top of the fault tree. Oftentimes, it is a catastrophic event that causes a system-wide outage. The top event is represented by a rectangle that has only an input without any output. Basic events, BE, represent root cause events that propagate up the chain of the system to cause a top event. The BE is represented by a circle that does not have any input. And intermediate events are the ones caused by one or more other events. And BEs cause intermediate events, which eventually cause TE. For example, intermediate events are represented by rectangles that have both an input and an output. Transfer events appear when a fault tree is too large to fit in a paper and a transfer event can be created. This way, we can replace one big part of the fault tree with a single symbol. Transfer events are represented by triangles. Transfer out events will have a triangle with output to the right of the triangle, while the transfer in event will have input to the top apex of the triangle. Underdeveloped events appear when there is insufficient information to develop a subtree. These are represented by the diamond or the rhombus symbol. Conditional events are the ones that act as a condition for an inhibit gate, which I'll explain in the next part of this video. And conditional events are represented by an oval symbol. And last year, house events are external events that are normally expected to occur, and they are represented by this shape that resembles a house. And gates represent how failures propagate through the analyzed system. Sometimes a single event can culminate in a top-level event, like a catastrophic failure. Other times, a combination of two or more different events can cause a top event. And logic gates indicate how events combine to propagate failure. Each gate will have only one output event and can have one or more input events. The most used gates in drawing fault trees are the AND gate, which can have any number of input events. The output event that it is connected to will occur only if all the input events happen. The AND gate has a rounded top out of which comes the output, as shown in the image here. This second one is a priority AND gate, which means an output event will occur only if all input events happen in a specific sequence. It looks very similar to the AND gate, just with an added line at the bottom. The OR gate tells us that an output event will occur if any or more of the events occur. The symbol for the OR gate will have a pointed top end from where the output emerges. As in the image, the other end is curved and is connected to the inputs. The XOR gate means an output will occur only if exactly one input element occurs. It looks like if you try to draw in a triangle inside the standard OR gate. And K divided by N, or voting gate, for this gate, there will be an N number of input events and one output event. The output event will occur if K number of input events occurs. It looks similar to the OR gate with a K divided by N written at the bottom end. The inhibit gate acts similar to the AND gate. An output event will occur when the input events occur and a conditional event also occurs. The symbol for the inhibit gate is this hexagon shown in the image. The input event is connected directly below the gate, and the conditional event is connected to the right of the gate. At the top of this is the output, like in all other symbols. So what are the types of fault tree analysis? FTA methods can be broadly classified into qualitative FTA and quantitative FTA. Qualitative FTA is used to gain insight into the structure of fault trees to analyze the vulnerabilities of a system. There are many different ways to go about conducting qualitative fault tree analysis, like minimal cut sets, or MCS, minimal pass sets, or MPS, and common cause failures, CCF. I won't go too deep on these methods, but MCS is used to identify the vulnerabilities of a system, MPS is used to determine its robustness, and common cause failures, so CCF, is used to figure out if multiple failures can be caused by one single element. And quantitative FTA, on the other hand, is used to derive the relevant numerical value for the fault tree. Assigning a numerical probability of failure helps to gauge a better understanding of the risks faced by the system. With that, teams can actually determine the priority of fixing various cut sets. Now let's go ahead and go through a few points that teams must follow in order to successfully complete fault tree analysis. The first step is to build a diverse team. That's important because conducting FTA is, in a way, a speculation based on facts. Experienced professionals in the field will be able to pick up excerpts from their professional life. So little resources and experience that will help provide good context to the decision they need to make and projections. They'll also be aware of the precise technical aspects of the system. Other team members with less technical knowledge can contribute by pitching out-of-the-box ideas and have other useful info about the analyzed system. Step number two is to identify failure causes. This is a critical step as the intermediate events and basic events are reverse engineered from the top event. The third step is to understand the inner workings of the system. The engineers work closely with the system and they should already have a good idea of how everything works. The team should collect the schematics of the system, specifications of different components, and other available manufacturer information. Studying these materials should build an understanding of how each subsystem and component are connected together. Then it's time to draw the FTA diagram. With the symbols and structure we covered in the previous section, the team can draw the graphical representation of the analyzed system using Boolean logic. And step five is to identify MCS, MPS, or CCF. The reason we are performing FTA in the first place will determine whether the team needs to find MCS, MPS, CCF, or a combination of those. Then I added an optional step here, which would be to assess the probability of failure. This is an optional step because accurately assessing the probabilities of different event failures is not an easy task. And some organizations decide not to do it at all. But more often than not, there are multiple pathways that can lead to the same failure event. So you need to prioritize them. And the next step is to develop risk mitigation strategies. The components and subsystems identified as cut sets should be bolstered. High priority has to be given to protect MPS, which is the minimum set of components that will keep the system operational. Strict maintenance schedules have to be maintained for CCFs as they can cause a multitude of issues. One potential risk mitigation strategy, especially for CCFs, is preventive maintenance. Many companies use a CMS system to help with maintenance schedules. This includes following the best spare parts management practices, so the maintenance team always has needed replacement components in stock. This effort has to be put in to minimize the probability of failure. As you can imagine, FTA for big and complex systems can quickly become so large that they can't be drawn on a single page or a whiteboard. That can be partially negated by using transfer elements. However, even with them, the diagram can become too large to handle, read, and comprehend. Faultree analysis software is a great solution for this type of problem. In addition, some applications have algorithms that can automatically identify quantitative aspects of FTA like MCS, MPS, and CCF. If the failure probabilities are known for the basic events, the different probabilities for top event and subsystem failures can also be calculated at the click of a button. This sort of analysis is a complicated process that can't be fully learned with just one video. You have to perform it on a few real-life examples to really get the hang of it. That being said, I hope this video gave you a good introduction to the topic and showed what to expect if you plan to use this method at your company and organization. And if you have any questions, of course, feel free to start a conversation in the comment section below. And if you learned something here, then make sure to like the video and subscribe to our channel so you can keep up to date with everything maintenance. And that way, when we publish a great new video, you'll be first in line to see it. And with that said, I'll go ahead and see you on some of our following videos where we'll be talking about other maintenance strategies. Cheers.